Yeshua, Jesus, the Christ, bless each and every one of the lovers of his truth and those who follow after Christ. I thank God for your lives. I thank you for tuning in on today, and let's get started. I do not want to make this a long share, but by now you know exactly how long it took me, and I'm going to allow, or not necessarily took me, but how long it took the Holy Spirit to flow through me to present this all to you, all right? He may present the same message through you in a shorter period of time, but through me, this is how he flows, and that's the way I'm going to go. Amen. I'm not going to try to be you. You're not going to try to be me, but we're going to be who he has created us to be in him. Hallelujah. Amen. So you are welcome to the channel, each and every one of you. And it's Sabbath for me, so happy Sabbath to you all. Whenever you're hearing this, it may be another day, but I pray that you're having a wonderful day on that day. All right. So the subject is, should we pray violent prayers? Should we pray these aggressive prayers? Should we be shouting? Should we be, you know, doing all of these things? Or should we just sit quietly and fervent, quietly and just in a you know, calm manner, cool, calm and collected, and just pray silently, you know, and just don't make any kind of ruckus. Is that how we should pray? All right. Well, the answer to those questions, both questions, would be yes and yes. There are times when we are going to pray violent, aggressive prayers. All right. Then there are times when we are going to be more quiet and reserved. In either instance, you should be able to hear from the Holy Spirit, first of all, okay? Because he's going to be the one that's going to lead your prayers, all right? In either instance. And so some of you may say, well, I can't hear from him if I'm yelling and screaming. Well, if you're yelling and screaming the word of God, you're going to hear from him, all right? Because he is the one who's bringing the word to your remembrance. You are already hearing from him. I'm going to show you from the scriptures that there are times when you're going to pray, where you may take a more quiet, stance in prayer. And then there are other times where you're going to take a more aggressive stance. All right. So there isn't a right or wrong way to pray as far as should we be aggressive or should we be quiet. But there is a way to pray that is wrong. And I'm going to show you what that wrong way is. All right. So when we look at Matthew chapter 6, we're going to start there. We see here, a passage that many use to support that we should not pray aloud and that, you know, our prayer should be short and to the point. Okay. But let's see what the scripture is really saying here. Let's see what the passage is really saying. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5 says, "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites." All right. So what's the subject so far? The subject is prayer. All right. In Christ's direction to them, this is Christ speaking, is that their prayers should not be prayers that are like the prayers of hypocrites. All right. Okay. So it says here, "When thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are." All right. And this is how they are. "For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men." All right. So, is the problem that they are praying in the synagogues? Is the problem that they are praying on street corners? No. The problem is that they are hypocrites and they are only doing this to be seen of men. All right. So that is their hypocrisy, that their prayer life is to be seen of men. It's not a genuine prayer. It's not a sincere prayer. Christ is not against us praying in the synagogue. He's not against us praying on the street corners. Okay. Or praying for men and women on the street corners. What he is against is hypocrisy and doing things just to be seen of men and women. All right. And I'll prove this by stating, he goes into stating, speaking about their reward. They're doing it for the reward. What is their reward? The praises of men. That's the reward. All right. All right. So, and to be seen of men, that's their reward. And so he follows through by saying, "Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, enter into your closet. And when you have shut the door, pray to your Father which is in secret. And your Father which is in secret shall" what? Reward you openly. So see, the reward is the issue right here on this part of the passage. It's a reward, the reward. See, God will promote you even from praying in your closet. They wanted their promotion of men. They wanted to receive their instant promotion, their instant praise of men, their instant acknowledgement even of their spirituality from men, all right? But if you are a person who is given to a prayer closet, okay? If you are a person who goes into a prayer closet, you won't have to go about proving to people that you are spiritual. They will know that you are a person who is wholly spiritual because you have a prayer life that is filled with the Holy Spirit's presence and leading and guidance. When you speak, the Holy Spirit will be speaking through you, all right? When you share the word of God, the Holy Spirit will be sharing through you. His presence will be evident in your life. So you don't have to stand on the corners just to be seen of men. Remember, that's the purpose of him telling them that. You don't have to stand in the synagogues or in the churches to show that, hey, I have a prayer life. I'm very spiritual. All right. But please know, Christ is not against praying in a synagogue. He is not against it. We know that the disciples and the apostles and the followers of Christ were not against praying in the synagogue. We have so many examples of them praying. And so we know that that was not the problem. And that was not Christ's instruction to them. The instruction was not to be a hypocrite. And the instruction was that they do not do things to be seen. Don't do things to be seen of men. All right. And do not seek your reward concerning or affirmation concerning your spirituality, holy spirituality from men. All right. Or women. So that is the point of that. And he goes on to say also in verse 7, but when you pray, use not vain repetitions. All right. So that's the next subject. So this is what many people say that we should use to as an example of not making long prayers. OK, but we're going to see here something else. OK, so they say here, but when you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do. So before he was speaking about hypocrites. Now in verse 7, who's he speaking about? Heathens. All right. Heathens. OK. And here's the problem with heathens. Let me continue to read. For they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Now, who's he speaking about? Heathens. Heathens are who? People who do not know God. All right. So when they don't know God, they think they can just come to him when they want to go to the real and the true and the living God. And they think that they can go to him and just start talking and saying a lot of things and speaking a lot of things to try to get his God's attention, because they are heathens who do not know God. They do not know that he is ever attentive to the prayers of the righteous. All right, as the scripture says. And so they don't know this. And because they don't know this, they do all sorts of things to try to get his attention. Oh, God. Oh, God. You listening, God? Are you there, God? Yeah. Listen up, God. Please hear me. Please hear me. Please hear me. They do anything to get his attention. All right. But his prayers are ever open to the cries of the righteous. You can cry all day long to him if you want to. He's listening. All right. But heathens think that they speak all day long and then they can call upon him all day long just to gain his attention. And we know this because it says they think they shall do this. For they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. They're not confident that God hears them. All right. They're not confident. And some of you would say, well, God don't hear sinner's prayer. That's another message. Okay. So because they don't have their confidence in Christ, and they can't have their confidence in him because they don't know him, they're heathens, unbelievers. All right. Are people who are not fully sold out to Christ. And so they're because they don't have that relationship with him, they go through a lot of unnecessary things to work themselves up, a lot like the prophets of Baal. When they begin to pray and they weren't getting a response from their false god, from Baal, what did they do? They started cutting themselves. They started doing all these things trying to get his attention because they didn't think that he was hearing them. All right? And Elijah, what did he do? He began to mock them, saying all sorts of stuff. Says maybe he's, you know, on the toilet, you know, so he can't hear you right now. He's easing himself. All of these things, all right? So, but when Elijah went to pray, he knew that God heard him. He knew, just as Christ, he said that God, when he was speaking at Lazarus' resurrection, he says, I know that you hear me. I only said these things so that they, you know, for their sakes, but I know when I pray that you hear me. I don't have to go through all of that. He knows that he has instant access to the Father because he is a man of prayer always praying and never fainting, as the scripture says, all right? Men ought to always pray and never faint. So this is the purpose of Christ telling them not to be repetitive in prayer, because they don't think they're being heard. But when you know that God hears you, you can come boldly to the throne. Amen? You can come boldly to the throne of God, and you can stay there as long as you want. As long as you want. So Christ is not against long prayers. He's against prayers of heathens, and he's against prayers of hypocrites. All right? And then he goes on and he teaches them to pray. All right? But he says in verse 8, but be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. After this manner therefore pray ye: Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. For if we forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive you your trespasses. All right. Just wanted to add that extra in there, because that's often neglected, even though it's not officially a part of the prayer. But after the prayer, he reminded you that. All right. Reminded us of that. Okay. So we see here the purpose of Christ telling them not to be as hypocrites and not to be as the heathen. And he explained to them what he meant. So what we learn from this and from the word of God is that Christ is not against praying in the synagogues. He's not even against praying in the street corners. When we read exactly what he's speaking about here, he's against hypocrisy. All right. He's against doing things to be seen of men. He's against trying to do things to receive our reward of men. All right. And he's encouraging us that even if we're in our closets, to go in our closets, God is going to reward us openly. He's going to affirm that we have heard from God and God has heard from us. All right. Openly before men. All right. And that we're in fellowship with him. And he's also taught us from this passage that we don't have to use vain repetition just to be heard. We can have full confidence that God hears us when we pray, because we are in constant fellowship with him, because we have accepted Christ, his son, and he's given us access to the Father. Amen. All right. So that's one thing that we need to get out of the way. So concerning how should we pray? Should we always take a calm stance? Should we always be quiet? Should we always, you know, just kind of be cool about it and, you know, don't make too much of a ruckus? Well, I say no, that's not true. There are times when we're going to have to pray effectual, fervent prayers. In fact, the scripture tells us that the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. You see that in James chapter 5, verse 16. So give me a moment just to get there. All right. James chapter 5, verse 16. And this is taking a little longer than I anticipated, but I'm just going with the Holy Spirit. It says, confess your faults one to another and pray. All right. So that's something that we need to include in our prayers, confessing faults. Now, remember, I said in another share that we confess our faults to one another, but we confess our sins to God. Now, there are times when you have sinned against people that you have to go to them and tell them that you have sinned against them. All right. We have to always remember that when we are praying, we want to make sure that we don't have any obvious sin or unknown sin, and even unknown sins in our lives. Okay, we want to pray concerning sins. That's going to help us in our prayer life. All right, we don't want anything standing and separating us from God or hindering our prayers. There are so many different things. There are things like mistreating your spouse, your wife. We see in Malachi where his prayers were hindered because of how he treated his wife. All right. And wives, that's, you know, you're in there too. Okay. You have to have the right attitude and respect your husband as well. Okay. All right. So confess your faults one to another, James chapter 5, verse 16, and pray for one another that you may be healed. Many people, your healing is connected to all of this. All right. That you may be healed. Because of confessing faults and also praying for one another, that you may be healed, that you may be healed. And the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now, what do you think that word fervent means? It means hot. It means passionate. It means on fire. You can't just be sitting quietly, Lord, I pray. Now, God can hear this, okay? He can hear this. But let me tell you, there are times when you're going to have to be fervent in your prayer. And for those of us who have a prayer life, you will agree that prayer, most of the time, when I say a prayer life, that means you get up at any time the Holy Spirit tells you to get up. You may be tired, but once you get started, you start walking the floor in prayer, all right? You start walking around your house, wall to wall, window to window, door to door, ceiling to floor. You know, whatever it requires for you to pray, all right? Whatever the Lord leads you to do. There are times when you take an aggressive, fervent stand. And for those of us who have a regular prayer schedule or prayer life, we pray all day long, meant to always pray, all right? You're in a constant mindset of prayer. But then those who have set aside certain times to pray, all right? You see in the scriptures where they set time aside to pray, specific times to pray, dedicated just to prayer. Do not bother me. Do not disturb me. This is a time that I am setting aside to pray, all right? And to hear. Prayer life is more than just speaking. It's hearing from the Father, okay? And so you will agree, if you have that kind of prayer life, at least for me, that my prayers and my set time to pray are most aggressive prayers, okay? And the set time to pray. Now, going throughout the day, I may be praying many prayers and many, M-A-N-Y, and many, M-I-N-I, prayers throughout the day. And they may be more reserved prayers. And they could be also aggressive prayers that are just short prayers, okay? But for me, in that certain prayer hours or hours that the Lord sets aside, because I don't even put a certain length on my prayer. I don't say, okay, I'm going to pray an hour every morning at, you know, a certain time in the morning. It's just get up and just pray. Okay. It could be an hour. It could be 30 minutes. It could be 2 hours. However long the Lord requires, I'm walking, I'm pacing, I'm praying, I'm speaking the word of God, declaring his truth. Amen. Sometimes with my eyes closed, sometimes just about to walk into furniture, but he's ordering my steps and he doesn't allow it to be. You know, it's amazing how the Holy Spirit will work in and through you and just guide your steps, even in the dark. All right. And so there are times when I'm praying at, you know, in the middle of the morning, in the middle of the night, whenever he nudges me, whenever he wakes me up and urges me to get up and pray. All right. And so that prayer most often is an aggressive prayer. It's like a warfare prayer. It is a warfare prayer. And if it's not warfare, it's declaration, aggressive, fervent declarations. I'm not standing up there for 2 hours or 30 minutes or however long the Holy Spirit has me going. I don't stand up there saying, "Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." That is a powerful prayer in itself, and I am not belittling it. That prayer alone, you break it down line upon line, listen, you can live off of that prayer, right? But there are some other areas of your life that you're going to need to attack, and you're going to need to advance, amen? And so you're going to have to take other scriptures from the word of God and press in. And I declare that many of you, and I'm telling you, that many of you are going through things because you're lazy. You are just so lazy when it comes to praying. You're just so lazy. Lazy, because it's going to take you taking out your sword out of its shield, all right, and taking that sword and advancing, all right? You know, like in fencing, if you watch some fencing, there are times when they're just cool, and then there are times you just have to advance. You have to be aggressive, okay? You have to advance forward, and that's what the word of God is like. You have to advance forward, and so you have to get up, and you have to be fervent. You can't just be laid back, all right? Because the devil is not laid back. He is aggressively moving forward against you. The kingdom of God suffers violence. That means we move into the kingdom violently, all right? And we have to take it violently by force. But then those who oppose are also pressing into that kingdom violently, pressing against those who are pressing in, I should say, all right? And so you have to be violent in your aggression towards the things of God and towards the things of the kingdom, all right? You can't be lazy. So there are times when we are going to take a more reserved prayer life, and there are times we're going to be very, very aggressive. When you look at the book of Acts, when you see them in Acts chapter 1, all right, and when they were waiting for the Holy Spirit, they were praying aggressively, okay? When you look in Acts chapter 2, after they had been released from prison, I'm going to let you go back and read that, all right? When they had been released from prison and they began to pray, all right, they prayed aggressively for what? For boldness. They prayed for boldness, or is that Acts chapter 4? Okay. Well, in Acts chapter 2, verse 42, the scripture says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and prayers. All right. But in Acts chapter 4, you'll see when they were released from prison that the first thing that they did when they got released was to pray for more boldness because they were being persecuted. And they referenced Psalm chapter 2 that speaks about the aggression, how Pilate and how the Gentiles and how Herod came against Christ. All right. They mentioned that. And then they said, and the same thing is determined against them, how people are coming against them with threatenings. All right. So they prayed to God for boldness. They prayed so fervently that the scripture says in verse 31, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. Now, believe me, when it says the place was shaken, I believe the place was shaken. All right. So there are times when you're going to have to pray violent prayers so much that it seems as if the place is shaking. Hey, let God shake the place if he had to. Amen. When the shaking of God occurs, no one will be harmed. Okay. And you won't have to worry about doing any harm to yourself like the jailer. All right. And when Paul and those were tied in the jail, when Paul and Silas began to pray, one prayed and one sang songs of praises and hymns unto the Lord. Amen. So we have to begin to become aggressive in prayer. Get rid of the laziness. This is why Satan is running amok all over the body of Christ, because people are too lazy to pray. Listen, I said in that previous share, I don't know if you heard it or if I said this before, but I'll say it again. The spirit of violence has been released against this land. The spirit of violence has been released against this land. Homosexuality is a violent spirit. It is a violent sin. It is a violent sin. It is a violent sin. And so it has been released against this land. If you don't believe me, read it in the scriptures. I may just do a separate share. Just reading those passages to you from Judges and from Genesis, to show you the violence. All right. And so when violence has been released in the land, it can come against them, and it can come against you who are not a part of them. All right. But it's definitely been released in this nation. So we're going to see violence in all sorts of form begin to break out even more because of this wicked spirit that has been released in this land. All right. So God bless you all. I pray that this has helped you. There were some other passages here that I wanted to go over, but I believe the Holy Spirit has said what he wants to say. I will include also one other thing here in 1 Timothy chapter 2. All right. It says, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications. That means to ask, to somewhat beg God, to compel God. So the scripture says that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come unto the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom to all, for all, to be testified in due time, whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle. I speak the truth in Christ and not lie, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. I will therefore that men pray everywhere. There's the answer to should we pray everywhere. It says that I would that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubting. So you don't have to wonder if God wants you to pray everywhere. You don't have to wonder if God is against us lifting our hands and being aggressive in prayer. You don't have to wonder anymore. The scripture has just made it plain. All right. So be bold, be strong, be confident, be aggressive, be violent in your prayer, and pray some of those Davidic prayers. Amen. So God bless you all. I love you. Christ loves you. And if you do not know him as your Lord and Savior, I compel you to repent. Amen. To repent. All right. So that he can hear your prayer, that you will not be as the heathen when you pray, just going and begging just to gain access, knocking on the door, wondering if he's hearing you. But you can come boldly and you can stay as long as you want. You can stay for a short period of time or a long period of time. But one thing you'll know for sure is that you can come confidently before the throne of grace. Amen. And obtain mercy, obtain help, obtain whatever you need in the time of trouble and in the time of peace. So God bless you all. I love you and take care.